This is a song that is 400 years old. It's an adaptation of an Edwin Ar- of of a 16th century piece called Besame Mucho. 16th century piece that I researched in the library and wrote guitar chords to, and we do it as a two-part setting called Benedictus.
But looking very fresh.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
You started off here, at least your first visit here, I think, was on the folk circuit, the folk singing circuit in the 60s, wasn't it?
Yes, that's so.
Several of your songs have been written around it. But, I mean, have you many happy memories or miserable memories of it?
Oh, no, absolutely happy. I lived with a family, the McCausland's, in Essex. I met their oldest son when I was hitchhiking through France, and I came back and lived here in 1964 and a lot of 1965. We lived out in Brentwood, and I began to play in little folk clubs, and that's really where I learned the craft of performing, and a lot of the early Simon and Garfunkel songs and hits, like Homeward Bound, and they're really about my travels in England. Homeward Bound was about a trip I took to Liverpool. So, yes, they were very, very happy.
Those were the days of Beatlemania and, of course, swinging London and the swinging 60s here. It must have been an exciting time to be taking part of, being part of the music.
Oh, it was a perfect time to be here. It was so exciting. When I first came, they said, "Have you heard of this group called the Beatles?" And, I mean, of course, I hadn't. And I thought that the Beatles, I said, well, I said only the English would come up with that pun, the Beatles. I said, this can't really
These guys
happen.
Will never make it. But you'd had, when you were in high school, long before you came to the folk circuit, you'd had a sort of minor hit, hadn't you? Was that working with Art Garfunkel, calling you a pair called Tom and Jerry, hadn't you? You had a hit.
Yes, we did. When we were 15 years old, we made our first record. That's how long I've been recording and writing. Yes, it was a minor hit nationally, but actually in New York City, which is our hometown, it was a top 10 hit. So I was sort of the star of my high school. Very pleasant to be when you're 15, 16 years old, the star of your high school. Or maybe you were, so maybe you know.
No. I was very quiet boy. I used to sit in the back.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Well,
he used to put me sitting in the back.
I see. Yeah. Well, should you ever return to high school, I recommend you do it as a star.
Yeah, life is easy. Were the teachers better to you because you were a star, or did they even know about it? Or did that give you your first taste of stardom and make you eager for it?
Well, you know, I wanted to be a rock and roll singer and writer from about the age of 12, although I never told anybody that, particularly my father, who was a musician and was opposed to rock and roll as a musical form. So I knew that at quite an early age, although I didn't envision that this would be my life, my life's career. But yes, at a very early point in time. How about you?
Yeah. That was such a long answer, I've forgotten the question.
At what point did you know that you wanted to sit and talk to people and earn your living that way?
Well, it's scarcely a living, Paul, but...
That's not what I heard.
Mm-hmm. Well, you and Paul Simon, it all started, didn't it? You were neighbours, or you lived along the same street, which just sounds incredible.
Three blocks from each other.
Three blocks.
We were 11 years old when we ran into each other. Right. We thought each other was the turned-on kid in the neighbourhood.
Right. And here you are as Tom and Jerry. Now, who was who? Who was Tom and Jerry?
I was Tom Graff,
right,
because I'm mathematical. He was Jerry Landis, because he had a girl he was chasing in junior high school, Sue Landis. But we were big Everly Brother fans. The Everlys are just gods to us.
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't realize how much time you'd spent in the UK during the 60s, and you did travel around and hear all our music.
It's my first home. When we hit in America, they thought we were a British group, because in those early days of the 60s, when we would live on Cable Street in the East End, bring our clothes to the coin-operated laundromat and take the tube to various parts of England, and we would train off to Grimsby and do a show at the folk club that night and then get back to the East End. They're very sweet memories. Mm.
I returned to the United States in December of 1965. After living a year here in England. And I went back because The Sounds of Silence had become a big hit, you see. So I returned. So, but I had to make this adjustment, this transition from being sort of relatively unknown in England to being semi-famous type scene in the States, you see. And, wow, there's ghosts on the stage, man.
You know what happened? The string popped out by itself. That's what it looks like, anyway. I see the peg just jumped right up.
So here I am back in the States, and very depressed, really, very down with the whole scene. And all the songs I was writing, same category down. Until last June, I started to swing out and get into a better mood. One day, I'm coming over the 59th Street Bridge in New York, and very groovy day it was, about 6 o'clock in the morning. You know, and it's one of those times when you know you're not gonna be tired for about an hour. Good times. So I started writing this song, which later became the 59th Street Bridge song, or Feeling Groovy. Slow down, you move too fast.
You got to make the morning last, just kicking down the cobblestones, looking for fun and feeling groovy. Ba-da-da-da-da-da, feeling groovy. Hello, lamppost, what you know when? I've come to watch your flowers growing. Ain't you got no rhymes for me? Do it and do do, feeling groovy. I got no deeds to do, no promises to keep. I'm dappled and drowsy and ready to sleep. Let the morning time drop all its petals on me. Life, I love you, all is groovy.
Last song that we heard there, Mrs. Robinson, I mean, that has changed the image of Mrs. Robinson's all over the world. So do they constantly come up to you and
say, it doubled our audience. We were popular before that came out, but in the late 60s, when The Graduate presented Mrs. Robinson, suddenly all kinds of people knew us. The cops knew us. The truck drivers would honk their horn at us.
Really?
We doubled our audience from that film.
Brilliant. And when you hit the dizzy heights of fame as Simon and Garfunkel, I mean, surprisingly, even though you were massive, it didn't last that long, did it? Because in 1970, you split.
I guess we did. Who knew?
Yeah.
We were popular with five albums in the second half of the 60s, and that is the Simon and Garfunkel career.
And you know, when you compare your solo stuff then to Simon and Garfunkel stuff, can you be objective? Or is it quite...
No.
Difficult? No?
I like to think I'm outside of it and I can look at it. I know that Simon and Garfunkel is way more popular than my solo work, but I have made 12 solo albums and I sing good without falling.
Did it hold you back at all when you and Art split up and he went into acting and you continued writing on your own?
Well, I didn't have the same amount of success that Simon and Garfunkel had, but I was the writer of for Simon and Garfunkel, and I continued to write songs, and I did have hits in the ensuing years. So, no, it didn't really hold me back. I never enjoyed the same amount of absolute mass popularity that Simon and Garfunkel had, but it was satisfying to me as an artist.